Thanks for being here. So I present myself quickly. So I'm Vianney Rancurel. I'm the director of research of Scality. And I'm going to present you three open problems and solutions. So the first bullet is actually the main description of the problem, how to deal with data storage and increasing number of data locations. Second bullet is actually I'm going to briefly talk about Zenko we presented last year at SDC 2018, which is a platform that helps you managing the different storage locations. And the highlight this year is we are going to present a new workflow engine, which is able to actually operate on those data. So what is the current state of data? So today, as you know probably, we have a combination of different technologies. So first, file systems, but now you also have object storage systems. So your data is actually dispersed in two different major technologies. Also, most of the companies and organizations have data on-premise, but also data on the cloud, as you know. So organizations have to maintain legacy storage platform for legacy applications. Also, they have to keep on the innovation and integrate new technologies. For instance, recently, the last years were object storage platforms. So this caused a huge heterogeneous park of data. And so that's the current state. Today, if you want to build a workflow or an application on top of this data, it will be very hard. So this is why we introduced this platform last year, so Zenko. So briefly, one single interface. So we chose an object storage protocol, REST-based, to access all your data. So basically, we ingest the metadata of all your systems, and we keep this metadata, a copy of this metadata in the central point. And this allows you to have a global visibility of all your data. And you can do search as well on the metadata. You can also schedule data migrations between the different storage locations. So that's one strong point. So you enable basically mobility across all your data storage locations. So this is open source, so you obviously have no vendor lock-in. And so at the end of the day, you can develop application faster because you have only one protocol to talk to. And Zenko takes over the complex interoperability challenges. So this is it. So this year, we introduced the workflow engine. So what's new? So it's based on Zenko. And the new thing is now you can build your own workflows on top of your data. You typically automate things. So let's suppose you have a petabyte scale object storage system and you have files and you don't know if you have viruses on those files. Then you can define a workflow which is going to scan all your files. And we'll see the different use cases we can do. But more or less, you can run those workflows on top of all of your data. The concept is not new. What is new is this is totally seamless, and you don't have to worry about where the data is and all. So if I go back to the Zenko as we introduced last year, there is only one concept to know, the concept of storage location. Actually, a storage location is a bucket or a mount point somewhere on the file system. And so this is the Zenko UI. So as you see here, you define your storage locations there. This is where you say, I got a file system, at this on this NFS server, or I got an object storage at this endpoint, you know. And you can view the list of all your endpoints. From there, you can browse your data here, or you can also search. And you have a global dashboard, and you have basically the total capacity of your storage system in front of you. You can also program what we call predefined workflows for actually replication and lifecycle. So replication is basically copying data from one storage location to another storage location. And lifecycle is basically moving, so basically copying and deleting at the source according to predefined rules. So this is it. So Zenko has been built on four pillars. So unified interface across all clouds, native cloud data format. So when we store, when you register, for instance, a bucket which is on Amazon, you can manage the data from Zenko, but you can also go to Amazon and access your data. It won't be in a weird Mongol format. It will be this is very, very important. We always maintain the native format for you to do whatever you want. It's policy managed, and you can also search on your data. So, as I said, you have predefined workflows: so replication, lifecycle, and out-of-band updates. So, the out-of-band updates actually is required for so this is the architecture. For ingesting the metadata of the different systems. So this is the architecture of Zenko. So this is actually one box, but the system is scaled out, so you can have as many boxes as you want. The main components are so cloud server, which is a protocol front, which is understanding the object storage API. Cosmos, which is browsing the different clouds and on-premise file system storage boxes, for instance. Ingesting the metadata back to the main metadata repository. BackBeat is doing all the asynchronous workflows, so replication and lifecycle, as I say. And Vault is doing the authentication. So when a user puts a file, goes to cloud server, first we authenticate, then we store the data in a temporary storage. I will explain why. We register the metadata in the database. And then BackBeat, which is the asynchronous replication component, reads back the data from the temporary storage and copies to the different clouds. So why do we do this? Because when you do multi-cloud, you pay the cost at the egress. So let's say the cloud one is our primary storage location. If we want to read back to copy to the other locations, for instance, we have to pay the price every time. So instead, we have a temporary storage, so we need to size more or less according to the workload you need. You put your files, and then BackBeat will do the asynchronous replication. So you have basically a high throughput, low latency I/O when you write, and everything is taken care of in the background. So this is it. So let's talk about the new workflow engine, so the exciting part. So what if now you want to define your own personalized workflows on top of your data? So now we have this unified interface across all storage locations. This is interesting to actually call functions on this data. So here, for instance, this is a random example, but I introduce quickly the concept. So you have some boxes which are representing data sources. You have some boxes which are representing actually functions. For instance, here it's Azure Cloud Functions, Google Cloud Functions, and Lambda Functions. You can make decisions. So you see you have one input and two outputs. You can also call local functions because we use Kubernetes, and you've heard about the serverless engines or function engines on Kubernetes. So you can run your own locally defined function on your on-premise if you want, and then we update. So what is transferred actually on the different arrows? So every arrow here represents one event. So for instance, the data source is every time I receive a file in a bucket, for instance, or a file in a storage location. I will tag my data. This is the first step, the red box. It's a very simple tagging operation. And we are passing through only the context. We don't pass the whole data. We just so it's just basically a context which is passed along all the boxes. And we tag, and the different functions are going to create tags or actually read the data and create new tags. And you can make decisions on those tags. So for instance, here, out of the red box, I got three arrows to the three different clouds. And basically, it means that I create three events. Basically, the event is split in three. And here at the decision point, I wait for the three events to finish, to the three processing. So it's actually a true synchronization point. And from there, we execute the decision. So either we run a local function, or if the criterion was successful, we directly update the metadata. So we'll see more interesting use cases, but this is more or less the so what are the use cases? So let's look at four main verticals. So the enterprise. So typically, you're interested in running antiviruses. You're interested in encrypting your data, potentially after the facts, compressing after the facts. So you can define custom policies there. Also compliance. So maybe you know that you have some laws, especially in Europe and soon in California, where, for instance, you cannot store files containing private information, so so-called PII, personal identifiers. But so that's relatively, so if we're talking about a credit card number, for instance, or an ID number, you can do a very basic grep. But you have actually some regulations that states that you have to, for instance, you don't have the right to store a license plate picture for more than 3 months. So on your storage system, you don't have the right to have a picture of a license plate. This is, for instance, in Europe with the GDPR, this is forbidden. So how do you enforce this? So with a workflow engine, for instance, you can say every week I run a workflow which is going to call, let's say, TensorFlow, a specific model, inception model for license plates, and do a recognition and check some specific metadata on the file, for instance, the creation time, and delete the file eventually. So this is for the enterprise vertical. For media and entertainment, what is interesting to do is detecting the hot and the cold videos and taking decisions on those. And for instance, deciding to store cold data on low tier storage, for instance, but also to do some kind of heuristics and avoid consuming CPU for nothing. So for instance, being ready to transcode the video on demand instead of transcoding systematically the videos, for instance. This kind of complex scenario, you can totally run them with the workflow engine of Zenko. In the healthcare, so typically in the healthcare industry, for compliance, they have to store on-premise, so especially in Europe, for petabytes of data. And they would like to use this data at some point. The problem is those data, they are labeled. You have the patient name on the pictures. So what you want to do, for instance, is de-identification to be able to use those pictures to train actually your AI models for doing medical image recognition, for instance. So this is a typical use case. For service providers, you are potentially storing billions of emails, and you would like to see if you have nasty files and so on. So you would be interested potentially to run anti-spam or after the fact anti-spam or antivirus at scale. So same architecture. So the only different thing is we are going to leverage actually a function engine on Kubernetes. And of course, the different cloud functions from the different providers. So I'm thinking about Amazon Lambda, Azure Cloud Functions, Google Functions, and so on. So this is it. So I'm looking at the time just quickly. Oh yeah, with time. So let's talk before I do a demo. Let's talk quickly about the function engine. So because they are the relatively new piece here. So what is it? So since Zenko is based upon Kubernetes, we can leverage those function engines. They are also called serverless engines. And the very interesting functionality is that the user can define functions from the command line in the language of their choices. For instance, Node.js or Python or Golang. And they create container images, basically, with their functions. And then they can declare those functions in Zenko. And actually, it's smarter than that. Zenko can auto-guess the different functions and integrate those functions in the workflow. So let's say you have a specific TensorFlow model that you want to run on your data. Then you can define the function with, let's say, Fission, which is a popular serverless engine. You define your function, you can test it locally, and then you can use it directly from Zenko. So that's the thing. So this is before doing the demo, this is a real-life use case. For instance, especially if you're in AI and TensorFlow. So for instance, here, what I want to do is every time I receive a new image in a bucket, I call my own TensorFlow model. And typically, I don't know if you will see later, but TensorFlow, I'm thinking about the Inception model, which is auto-tagging the pictures, is giving a score to the different labels and tags he has guessed. And if you're not satisfied with the scores, typically bad scores, like less than 0.8, you can make the decision to call a cloud service. So, and you have to pay for that. So at the end of the day, so you pay, but with the actual tags that were guessed by the paying service, you can train your own model and then update the tags. If you are satisfied with your own score, you can directly update. So just a basic example. So the demo. I prepare some some basic So this is actually Zenko, as you see here. The main dashboard, so actually I have no data stored. Here I can define my storage location, and actually I have only one storage location. Okay, that's the last command line stuff I type. So here I can browse my locations, and actually I have nothing. Okay, so I need to create a bucket. So my default storage location is a local file system, and we call it US East 1 because we are Amazon compliant actually, and this is the name of the default location in Amazon. And here you can find the different predefined workflows I was talking about that were presented last year. And now you have the workflow builder here. So let's say, for instance, so we create a new workflow. Okay. A very simple workflow which is going to add tags. So here I have my different boxes. So for instance, I will take the source, what we call a source box. here I will say every time there is a new file which is stored in the demo tag bucket, it will trigger an event. So from there, I can, this is the most basic one, so basically adding a tag, so SDC 2019, that's the name of the box. Okay. And when I'm done, I update the tags on the metadata system. That's, so my workflow is correct. I save it. I close it. So by default, it's inactive because you can take your time for editing. And when you're ready, you enable it. So. Okay, so it's active. Now I can go to my browser, create my bucket. And I can upload files. So for instance, one picture. Okay, so actually I have a dashboard. If I want to see how many success I have, how many failures, I can have the detail. So for instance here, I have put it one file and I know that I had, in the first box, I had one successful execution, and for the update box, I had also one successful execution. So now if I go back to my browser, the workflow has been executed. I can check the tags here, and you see SDC 2019, the tags have been created. So that's a very basic one. So now let's say we want to use a TensorFlow model. So my source would be a bucket called demo TensorFlow. And so this time I'm not going to tag, but I'm going to call a function. And so we use Fission to run the local function actually. And the name of the function is actually autotag. So basically, so the famous Google model Inception is going to take the picture and describe it with 5-6 tags. So here, so the model has been validated. I can save it. So now I need to enable it. Okay. I create my bucket. So the only thing I did was going to the TensorFlow GitHub, downloading the inception.zip, the famous one, model, and making it a use Golang, a Go function, and declaring the Go function inside Fission. And now this is prepared. So the beauty of the serverless framework is that it's going to auto-scale the processing according to the load. And remember, we are running on Kubernetes, so we can have 5, 10, 20 nodes. And this is, so potentially my data sources are huge. We're talking about petabytes on different locations. And now I just basically have an auto-scaling system that is able to operate on my data. So let's upload some objects. So that there are some random pictures from AI repositories. So I need to check the number of executions. Probably done already. So we're here. Oh. Okay, it doesn't work. So let's there is apparently a failure. Oh, he said successful execution. Well, it takes time, so what I'm going to do is to call a cloud function. So I'm going to call Azure. So it's a service called Azure Community Services, so the cloud vision. Azure Vision. Make it active. So let's try with one file first. Okay. Okay, so the Azure function call actually. So Azure was able to find 17 tags for my image. So now I'm going to send a little bit more images. So okay. Okay, so he found tags. For instance, here it said it's a vehicle, it's a motorbike. I can download the picture. Okay, it's a motorbike. So now, suppose I inject petabytes of data and I want to search. So we go to the search panel. And here, let's say I want to search for all the vehicles. Okay, so he found two. We can check. So this is a vehicle, obviously. And this is probably the motorbike, yeah. And so on. So we can, for instance, say, let's say we want to find all the animals. Okay. This is obviously an animal. And this is another one. So this is a very basic workflow with just one function. So we can build more complex workflows. So let's do that. I like risk. So this is an alpha version, just if you didn't notice. So that's curious. TensorFlow didn't work. Okay. So I will take this one. So I will show an example of a decision. So here I create I will take all the new events for files coming from this bucket. And I will call a specific function which is an EXIF extractor. So I will put pictures with EXIF symbols. So this function is actually called EXIF extract. And I will ask to extract actually the orientation of it's a specific EXIF field inside pictures. And I will make a decision on this field. So for instance, if the orientation field is 3, which corresponds to a 180 degrees rotation, I will rotate the image. So here, I create a link, and I will simply do orientation equals 3. And if it is the case, I will call another function, which is an image processing function, which is called image. And I will ask to do a rotation of 180 degrees. And actually, I don't need to update anything because we are going to operate on the data and not on the metadata. So this is important to understand. So I use what we call a stopper, which is basically end of the workflow. And if the image doesn't contain the tag, we do nothing. So this is a workflow. I made a syntax error. Okay. I can close it. I enable it. Now I create the bucket. And I will put a file. So the funny thing about this particular demo is that I use macOS, and macOS is auto-rotating the images. So even though the image has an incorrect orientation, at the core of the Apple system, there is an image processing routine which is auto-rotating the image. So for the sake of my demonstration, I will really use an image which is rotated by 180 degrees, but the Mac is going to present it the right way. So my workflow is actually going to rotate it the other way. That's a funny thing about it. But this is just for the sake of the demo. So I upload my file. So for instance, this is it. Okay, so it's processing. So you have various steps in the workflow, so it takes time. So the thing is, it appears to be slow, but it works with millions or billions of files. So it's not just the slowness of one operation which counts, it's actually the parallelism which is interesting in this case. So here you can see output. It created one file, which is actually the image rotated. So just to show, and we can go back to the editor, we executed actually this workflow asynchronously. So what works with one image works with thousands, millions, billions of images. So typically, because we use proper queuing, so we use Kafka for our queuing. We use MongoDB for metadata and so on. I mean, this is it. Go back to the presentation. Do you have any questions? Yeah?
So can you go to the architecture diagram?
Yeah.
So how is it deployed, right? Is it on-premise or is it on cloud? The central box.
So the central box can be on-premise or can be in the cloud. And actually, so to run Kubernetes, because it runs on Kubernetes, to run Kubernetes on-premise, we use our own distribution of Kubernetes, which is called MetalCube. And tomorrow, Nicolas is going to do a presentation here. So if you're interested, yeah.
So how is the configuration information stored, like all these workflows, and in case of the enterprise use case, the key, encryption keys and all that? So do you, like if my deployment is on cloud,
yeah,
do you store that data in cloud as well?
So we use actually for everything sensitive, we use Kubernetes secrets. So there is nothing in clear or somewhere. So either for the cloud keys, because if you want to store on Amazon, for instance, you need an Amazon key. So when you configure your storage location, and I can show you in Orbit, here. If I want to create a storage location which is on Amazon, for instance, Amazon S3, it asks for an access key. The secret key will be obfuscated at the time you type, and it will be stored actually in a Kubernetes secret. So we never see it. So if you go back here, same for the cloud functions. I called an Azure function, and for that you need to define an Azure function. I don't know if you did it before. It's like doing a Lambda function. In Amazon Lambda, you do the same thing with Azure. You upload your code, and then you define a service, a REST service, and you have a function key, which is optional, but if you don't actually secure it, you can, since it's, you have to pay at every request, can be very expensive. So you generate a function key, and this function key, you store it once in Zenko. It's stored in the Kubernetes secret, and that's it. You know, just,
so is there any performance implication if I put it like, if I put Zenko and I want to ingest data to AWS, and I want to store it in AWS? So directly putting data on AWS versus the data going through Zenko, how is the, like, is the performance same?
So the performance is the same. So generally, when you use Zenko, you want to do a multi-cloud. So you want to store at least on two or three clouds. So we use this temporary storage, like I was explaining here. So basically, the throughput perceived by the user is the throughput of storing on the local storage. And you can size it to, say, let's say 500 terabytes. So it's to be large enough for user to have enough space. And then Backbeat is taking over asynchronously of the replication to the different clouds. So the user doesn't actually pay the price. And probably the experience will be better than a cloud, because when you directly upload on the cloud, you have to wait for the cloud to say, OK, in this case, you don't. So that's better. So you can, so this is one box. And so everything is built to be scalable, scale out. So obviously, the stateless services are scale out, but also the stateful services. So we chose carefully, you see, Mongo for the scale-out capabilities. Kafka is the same, Redis is the same. So you can have, for instance, 5 stateful nodes, and you can lose 2 out of 5, so you can have a pretty good resilience. And for everything stateless, function included, because that's the beauty of the thing, you can have hundreds of machines. So those boxes, you can run them, of course. First, you can run Zenko directly on an hosted Kubernetes, like EKS, AKS, or GKE, for instance. But you can also deploy on-premise, and that's the thing we do at KDT as well. So our own Kubernetes distribution on-premise, which takes care of the storage. So the project is called Metal Cube. It will be, as I said, it will be presented tomorrow. If you want to run on-premise the whole thing, you can. If you want to run the cloud, you can. This is really hybrid processing. And on top of this now, you can run a local cloud function on your remote data or remote cloud function on your local data if you have a local storage. So I just proved it more or less. This is it. So the UI, this is the only part which is for now in SaaS mode. So the UI is optional. You can operate everything from the command line. Everything is REST API. For now, the UI is free, so in SaaS mode. But everything else is open source. Yeah.
Is there any dependency on scalability of the product, or is it just generic?
It works on any, so can show you. So we support S3, Ceph, DigitalOcean, Google Cloud, Azure, NFS, and of course our own storage, Wasabi, you know, and counting. And if you are S3 compatible, obviously it works. But for instance, Storage, the company that was presenting just before, we are actually in the process of interacting with them. Any other question? Okay, thanks a lot.